Okay, we ready? Okay, the sutta tonight is one you've probably heard before a few times. This is the Anupada Sutta. One by one as they occurred. Thus have they heard on one occasion the Blessed One was living at Sawati in Jetta's Grove, Anath and Pendika's Park. There he addressed a monk thus. Monks, venerable sir, they replied, the Blessed One said this. Monks, Sariputta is wise. Sariputta has great wisdom. Sariputta has wide wisdom. Sariputta has joyous wisdom. What is that? Sariputta has quick wisdom. Sariputta has keen wisdom. Sariputta has penetrative wisdom. Again, anytime you hear the word wise or wisdom is talking about dependent origination and the impersonal nature of everything. During half a month, monks, Sariputta gained insight into states one by one as they occurred. Now, Sariputta's insights into states one by one as they occurred was this. Here, quite secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, Sariputta entered upon and abided in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thinking and examining thought, with joy and happiness born of seclusion. Now, the word jhana is a really misunderstood word. Almost everybody that talks about jhana, they say that it's concentration, deep concentration. And actually, the word jhana means a level of understanding. When you go from one jhana to the next, you have a deeper understanding of what you're doing with the meditation. And you start understanding more and more clearly what the Buddha was talking about. Okay. And the states in the first jhana. The thinking, the examining thought, the joy, the happiness, and unification of mind. Now, this next part is the five aggregates. The five aggregates and the four foundations of mindfulness are the same thing. The four foundations of mindfulness, body, feeling, the four foundations, okay, mind and mind objects, okay, the five aggregates, body, feeling, perception. Perception and feeling are always conjoined, they're always together. If you have a pleasant feeling arise, your mind says that's pleasant. If you have a painful feeling arise, your mind says that's painful. Perception is the very beginning of your conceptual thinking. We only think in concepts. This is why language is so tricky, because I had to learn how to translate by giving interviews. I have to be able to translate what you say and what you mean into whether it's going along with what the Buddha was teaching or not. So it's kind of a tricky thing. So there's perception, there's, they call them formations, Jnanananda, very intelligent, remarkable monk who I had the chance to be with a couple of times. In his books, he calls he calls formations preparations. Now, formations are body, speech, and mind. Okay. Now, they're always at the first part of dependent origination, and this roughly means that this is the potential for these things to arise. So when he calls them preparations, it's closer to the actual meaning of the word sankhara, which is a Pali word that's always translated as formations. But these are the preparations. This is the potential for these things to arise. That's why they're preparations. So I like that definition a little bit better. So that's the formations, and then you have mind. So you have mind objects. That's part of mind. And anytime you hear the five aggregates, it's also talking about the four foundations of mindfulness. Now, here in this sutta, instead of saying body, they say contact. This is much more accurate as we go deeper when you get into what's called the arupa jhanas, where you're in a mental state, and the only time you feel your body is when there is contact. Okay? So he uses the word contact because it's more accurate with the other kinds of jhana that I'm going to be talking about tonight. Now, I understand that a lot of people they have this wrong idea that a jhana just makes your mind go deep in concentration. And it's only good for developing psychic abilities. Although you don't hear of many people getting into deep jhana and experiencing psychic abilities. They're not seen very much, flying in the air, reading other people's minds, which has always made me wonder, why would you want to read another person's mind? They have as much nonsense in their mind as you have in yours. Why would you want to find out what they're thinking? Wow, waste of time. So, but jhana does not mean concentration. It does not mean that you're going to be developing psychic abilities. Jhana is a level of your understanding. When you get to the first jhana, you're starting to understand how the meditation actually works. And we'll go through all of the different jhanas, and I'll explain each one of them to you. But the thing that's most interesting, because there is a book that has become very, very popular, it's a book on the commentary of the Buddha's teaching. This book is called the Visuddhimagga. It was written about 1,000 years after the Buddha died, when there was a lot of confusion of different groups of Buddhists saying this or that, and they wrote that book to try to pull everybody together. But when it came to meditation, the person that wrote the book, his name was Venerable Buddhaghosa. He didn't know anything about meditation. He was a scholar, and he was a Pali scholar. But before he had become a Buddhist, he had memorized all of the Vedas, the Hindu teachings. Actually, not Hindu at that time. They didn't have Hindus. That was only came around 1800s, that word. He was a Brahmin. So he didn't know what the Buddha taught about meditation, but he knew what the Brahmin said. So he incorporated their method of doing meditation into the Buddhist text and used Buddhist words and ideas. And that's where a lot of the confusion about jhana comes from. Mahasi Sayadaw, when he started up teaching straight vipassana, he practiced the jhana practice, the one-pointed concentration that they teach in the Visuddhimagga. But also, this book, it divides jhana practice and insight practice and makes them separate meditations. And that's caused so much confusion. It's just remarkable. This sutta puts the insight in each jhana. And this is the way the Buddha actually taught. In the Visuddhimagga, they say that the Buddha taught 40 different kinds of meditation. Well, that's not true. He taught one kind of meditation. There's 40 different objects of meditation. But he only taught one kind of meditation. And that's the meditation that I'm showing you right now. What I'm showing you is right effort. Okay? Now, right effort is part of the teaching in the Eightfold Path. Every time you use the six R's, you are practicing the entire Eightfold Path at that time. And we'll talk about that later as we go through some things. So right effort is the kind of meditation that the Buddha taught. There's four parts to it. David. Okay. Then we'll do it this way. Okay, there's huh? No, this is okay. There's four parts to right effort, which is not being taught very much by people that are doing meditation. The first part is recognizing when something unwholesome arises. What are we talking about here? Something unwholesome. That means you have a hindrance arise. Okay? And the reason that it's unwholesome is because of the wrong belief in a personal self. I am that. The second part of right effort is releasing the unwholesome and that means don't keep your attention on whatever pulls your attention away. Just let it be there by itself. Relax the tension caused by that movement of mind's attention. Now, the third part of right effort is bring up something wholesome. Okay, when you relax and let go of that craving, your mind is very clear, your mind is bright, and it has no distraction in it. So, that's bringing up something wholesome, but I also add, re-smile. Why do I want you to keep smiling? Because it improves your mindfulness. It improves the speed at which you can observe what's happening. Now, it also brings up joy. Joy is a good thing. It's a happy feeling. Now, there's five different kinds of joy. Three kinds of joy anybody can experience at any time in their life when the conditions are right. The first kind of joy is a happy feeling and it's goosebumps. And it's really nice, but it's just there for a short period of time and it fades away. The next kind of joy is like a flash of lightning. It can be a real happy feeling and it can be really intense. But it only lasts for a short period of time and then fades away. The next kind of joy that can arise is like standing in the ocean and you just have a wave of joy come over you and it's really nice. And then another wave coming over you. These kind of joy can be experienced by anybody. It just depends on the conditions at that time. The last two kinds of joy only occur through mental development. The next kind of joy that arises, it arises because your mind becomes more peaceful, more calm. This is called uplifting joy. You feel very light in your mind and light in your body. It has excitement in it. It's really good stuff. The first time you really experience it, you go, yeah, this is why I'm meditating. This is good. I've been looking for this for a long time. But it has excitement in it. The last kind of joy is called all-pervading joy, and this is the awakening factor of joy. It doesn't have so much excitement in it. It's just a really happy feeling. So, when you get into the first jhana, you're going to experience this uplifting joy. You're going to feel light and happy, and it's really nice, but you don't hang on to it. You just let it be there by itself, and it will fade away. Right after that, your mind is going to get very tranquil, very peaceful and calm, and you're going to feel more comfortable in your mind and in your body than you've ever felt before. This is called happiness. The difference between happiness and joy. And this is from a commentary. Not all commentaries are bad. Now, suppose you were in the desert and you didn't have any water. And in the distance, you saw an oasis. And you started towards the oasis. As you got closer to it, you started having a lot of joy arise. Now I'm going to get something to drink. And there's a lot of excitement with that. And it is a happy feeling. But you get to this pool in the oasis, and you jump in the water. And the water is exactly the right temperature. And your mind goes, ah. And your body goes, ah. That's happiness. So the joy you experience, the uplifting joy, has the excitement in it. But when that fades away, then you feel this strong tranquility and comfort in your mind and in your body. And your mind becomes unified. Your mind becomes, it's like it's pulled together and it stays on your object of meditation for fairly long periods of time. So, okay, the contact, feeling, perception, formations, and mind. That's the five aggregates. The enthusiasm, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. A lot of people have the idea that once you get into jhana, all these things happen at the same time, and it's not like that. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. They happen one thing at a time, and you will notice that. This is where you start to see up close and personal the anicca. This is when you see change happening. Anicca means that there's always things that are changing. Nothing remains static. Nothing remains the same. Everything is in a state of change. And because it's always changing, it's always moving, there's some unsatisfactoriness in that. There's some dissatisfaction that arises. And you're going to see the impersonal nature of everything. These things all occur because conditions are right for them to come up. Then they happen one thing at a time. And this is something that an awful lot of meditation teachers spend in a real big amount of time focusing on impermanence, suffering, and not self. Oh, everything is like that. But they turn it into an intellectual knowledge, where in fact it is an experiential knowledge. Okay. He understood thus, so indeed these states not having been come into being. Having been, they vanish. Regarding those states, he abided unattracted. He didn't hold on to anything. He let it be there by itself, unrepelled. He didn't try to push anything away. Independent. He saw that this is a natural occurring process. Detached, free, dissociated. It's still talking about the impersonal nature of how this process works. With a mind rid of barriers. Every time you get into a jhana, your mind is pure. You don't have any hindrances. But when your mindfulness gets weak, okay, you're not in the jhana anymore. Now you have a hindrance come up. Now, don't look at the hindrances like they're some kind of a problem. They are not. They are your teacher. They are showing you where you have an attachment. And as you use the six R's and let go of that attachment, you're purifying your mind, and that way you can get back into the jhana fairly quickly. But anytime you have a hindrance, you're not in that state at all. That's why you need to become familiar with the six R's. You have to really be friends with the six R's. They will take you all the way to arahatship. So it's a real important part of the practice. Don't neglect the six R's. Use the six R's. When I talk about the Eightfold Path, instead of calling right effort, I call it harmonious practice, because that's what the six R's are. It is a harmonious practice. And you'll get the Eightfold Path later. He understood there is an escape beyond this. So once you get into the first jhana, that's all good and well. Now you get to continue on. So you know there's still more to do, but this is a heck of a good start. Everybody that experiences the first jhana has the potential to experience Nibbana. That means when you get to the first jhana, you have the potential to go deeper and experience getting off the wheel of samsara eventually. Okay, again, with the stilling of thinking and examining thought. Sariputta entered and abided in the second jhana. So with the stilling of thinking and examining thought, this is when I'm going to tell you, don't verbalize your wish in your mind. That's the stilling, that's the thinking and examining. Okay, so you let that go. This sutta, or this jhana, excuse me, is called the Noble Silence Jhana, because you don't verbalize anymore. So now your mind is more quiet. Okay. He abided in the second jhana, which has self-confidence and stillness of mind, without thinking and examining thought, with joy and happiness born of collectedness. Once you get to the second jhana, you start thinking, you know, I'm starting to catch on. This is good. I'm starting to understand. That's why it's called a jhana, because now you're at a different level of your understanding. You're starting to catch on. You're starting to teach yourself how this actually works. And this self-confidence starts to carry with you into your daily activities. You start to have more confidence and more balance in your mind, little by little. You still are going to have some things arise that are going to knock you off balance, but eventually your confidence is going to start to grow, and you're going to start to see more and more clearly, why am I doing this to myself? Why am I causing myself so much pain? And you start to recognize that, and you start changing the way you think and the way you act. And your mind starts to become softer because you're practicing loving kindness. You're practicing your generosity. You're giving that feeling to your friend. And that causes a lot of self-confidence. I'm helping somebody else. When you get off retreat, call up your spiritual friend and see what their week was like. You'll be surprised what they say. Okay, now the joy that happens in the second jhana is much stronger. And you start to feel very, very light in your mind and in your body. There are some few students that I have out of, say, 3,000 students or 4,000 students, however many students I've taught. There's been 4 or 5 people that the joy became so strong that they actually started to lift off the ground. They lift off for a little bit, and then they come back down, and then they go back up. It happens. When that joy fades away, that uplifting joy, that incredible happy feeling, then your mind becomes even more peaceful and calm. And you feel even more comfortable in your mind and in your body. Now this is where you really are starting to see, yeah, I am learning this stuff. This is a different level of understanding than when I was in the first jhana. Okay, now each jhana is a different meditation. So when you get to the second jhana, you have different things arising. They're not going to be exactly the same as they were before. And your understanding of how this process works becomes deeper. And it starts to be kind of fun. Having a light mind like with that joy is amazing. And the states in the second jhana, the self-confidence, the joy, the happiness and unification of mind. The contact, feeling, perception, formations in mind, or preparations in mind, as the case may be. So you have insight knowledge while you're in the jhana. And this is decidedly different than what most people are teaching in their meditation. When you get into a one-pointed kind of concentration, your mind becomes more attached to your object of meditation to the exclusion of other things. I'll show you the difference. When you're practicing the kind of meditation that 95% or 98% of the people doing meditation are practicing today, your mind is on your object of meditation. It gets distracted. Now, when you're practicing one-pointed concentration or absorption concentration, what happens is the instructions say, recognize that your mind is distracted and immediately come back to your object of meditation. Okay, this does this to your mind. It makes it more one-pointed. And you'll just stay on that object of meditation for a longer period of time. It generally takes quite a bit longer to develop this kind of meditation. It doesn't work so fast. What I'm teaching you is a little bit different. Your mind is on your object of meditation. That's the same. Your mind gets distracted. That's the same. But what I tell you to do is don't keep your attention on the distraction. Relax the tension and tightness caused by that distraction. Smile and bring that smiling, pure mind back to your object of meditation. Now, one of the things that a lot of the Indians, they've been practicing lots of meditation. They've been doing Goenka-style meditation for 40 years or 30 years. And then they came and they started practicing with me. And their progress in the meditation was very fast. And they couldn't believe it. They were going through these jhanas really quickly, in 2 or 3 days. And one of the things that I tried to impress on them was, you know, the Buddha, when he was out teaching, he was not teaching the most educated of people. He was teaching farmers that were not intellectually strong. And they were busy. They didn't have a lot of time to mess around. So he had to teach them something that was simple, easy to understand, and it had to work quickly. Now, when I was doing straight Vipassana, I had 20 years of practice. The first 5 years of the practice, I was figuring out what the meditation wasn't. Before I figured out what it was. 5 years. When I started doing this practice by reading the suttas and that sort of thing and seeing what the Buddha was talking about, getting into jhana, 1 day, 2 days, getting into the fourth jhana, which is a very advanced meditator. 3 days, 4 days. And these people that have been practicing for years and years and years had that kind of progress in the meditation. Boy, they were really enthusiastic about that. They thought that was just great. And it's just because of being able to recognize craving and how to let it go. Now, when I give talks all over the place, the first time I give a talk to a group of people, one of the first things I talk about is, what is craving? And I try to get people to answer that. Oh, it's desire. Well, yes and no. There's more to it than that. How are you supposed to recognize craving when it arises? All of a sudden it gets quiet. How are you supposed to let go of craving? So by that time they're starting to pay attention. And then they say, okay, this is pretty simple. Craving is the I like it, I don't like it mind. If a pleasant feeling arises, I like it. A painful feeling arises, I don't like it. That's the very beginning of the wrong belief in a personal self. So anytime you see any tension and tightness in your mind, in your body, there is craving. Okay? So you can recognize it. But when you're practicing one-pointed concentration and your mind gets distracted and you immediately come back to your object of meditation, you don't even recognize craving. You're bringing that craving back to your object of meditation. And that gets you off of the Buddha's path. That gets you into one-pointed concentration. So this one little extra step that the Buddha came up with of letting go of the craving, being able to recognize it and see how hindrances arise and all of these kind of things, you're teaching yourself more and more about how mind works. And you are teaching yourself. And that's one of the things that makes this practice fun. Because you are teaching yourself. And you're seeing it directly. This isn't some philosophy to talk about. This is direct experience. So, that's the difference between, there's a lot of people that talk about having a nimitta. A nimitta is a Pali word that means a sign arise when you're doing your meditation. The sign that they're talking about when you get deep enough in your concentration, there's a... It's like a disc that appears in your mind. And it's like a very bright moon. And then you start to do things with that, and you can get it to bounce around and get big and get small, and you can play with all of that. But that's not the teaching of the Buddha. That is leading towards one-pointed concentration and into the belief of reincarnation instead of rebirth. And I'll explain that later. So when you're practicing the way the Buddha taught, he he was teaching these farmers how to do the meditation. Well, you only have to sit for a short period of time, but you have to use right effort to do this and be able to relax and smile and come back to your object of meditation. Your progress is fast and it's easy. One of the biggest problems that I have with teaching people that have done other kinds of meditation is that they try too hard. They push. They try to make mind be the way they want it to be. And that is the one-pointed concentration, and that causes all kinds of problems. And people that do one-pointed kinds of concentration, if they really are pushing hard, can make themselves go crazy. Now, there was a book that was written on one-pointed concentration jhanas. And the author, who was a meditation teacher, he said, well, there's only about 4 or 5 people that go crazy from doing the meditation out of 1,000. 4 or 5 people go crazy by doing the meditation? What's the matter with that picture? That means that they're teaching a meditation that's dangerous. This, what I'm showing you, is not. What I'm showing you is how to live a more harmonious, happy life. And you won't go crazy. So, okay. Again, with the fading away of joy. Sariputta abided in equanimity, mindful and fully aware, still feeling happiness with the body. He entered upon and abided in the third jhana, on account of which, noble ones announce, he has a pleasant abiding, who has equanimity and is mindful. So what happens is the joy fades away. It's too coarse a feeling for your mind. And you're going to start feeling very nice and tranquil and comfortable. Your mindfulness is going to be sharper. Now, you're still going to hear things. You're still going to feel things. If I come up to you and I say, I want to talk to you for a moment, you'll hear me. You'll hear what I say. Or if a fly or a mosquito lands on you, you'll feel it. But it doesn't make your mind shake. Your mind just says, okay, that's there. There is that sound. There is a motorcycle that just went by. I know that. But it doesn't make your mind shake. So you have full awareness of things that are around you, but it doesn't pull your attention away. Now, the interesting thing with this, getting into this jhana, is that you really do start to understand more and more about the feeling of equanimity. That means balance in your mind. And as you lose tension and tightness in your mind, you don't feel places in your body. You don't feel your hands. You don't feel an arm. Eventually, your whole body is going to disappear, and the feeling that was in your heart goes up into your head. Don't push it back down, ever. That can cause you to have major problems. Stay with the loving kindness when it comes up here. That's a real good sign. Still, you need to practice your smiling, your light mind, your happy mind, your comfortable mind, your balanced mind. And this states in the third jhana, the equanimity, the happiness, the mindfulness, the full awareness, and unification of mind. The contact, feeling, perception, preparations, and mind. So you still have these insights while you're in the jhana. These states were, the enthusiasm, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention. Now at each level, your equanimity gets stronger. At first, it's not very strong. But you get to the second jhana, there's more balance in your mind. When you get to the third jhana, you can have a loud sound happen, and it'll just go through you. It doesn't make you jump. Now, people that practice one-pointed concentration, they really, really hate sound. I went to a retreat in Santa Fe, New Mexico. It was at a beautiful place, but they didn't have any air conditioning. And it was like 95 degrees. And these people are, there's a whole bunch of people that are doing this one-pointed concentration. Now, one of the things one of my teachers told me was, sound is a thorn in the side of a meditator. So sometimes somebody would close the door a little bit too loud and everybody in that was meditating would be boinked. And then they started complaining about the fan that we had. I want to turn the fan off. It's 95 degrees and there's no wind. No, we're not going to do that. I'm sorry. You have to put up with the sound. Oh, but it disturbs my meditation. Why? Because their concentration was too deep and their mindfulness was almost non-existent. What I'm teaching you is a balance of this. Yes, there are going to be sounds. Sometimes somebody will close the door and it'll be too loud. Or there's going to be a bug that comes around and lands on you. But it's not going to make your mind shake because you're balanced with mindfulness and your collectedness of mind. So you know it's there, but it doesn't disturb you. Generally speaking, when people are doing one-pointed concentration, when they get to the third jhana, they don't feel things with their body. Now, there was a time when I was in Thailand, and there was a boy that was 12 or 13 years old. He's really a good meditator, and he could get deep into meditation. And he came and he was going to show all the monks, the head monk wanted him to show them what the meditation would do if they were careful and they practiced correctly. And he got into his meditation and he was sitting there and the head monk came up with some chopsticks and he poked him a few times, nothing. Hit him on the head, nothing. He got a bell, put it right by his ear, clanged it loud. No reaction at all. Then he took the boy's hands and he put them up over his head like this. And his hands eventually just moved down until they touched some part of his body, and then they stayed there. And then they had him come out of the meditation and ask him, did you feel that poking and I hit you on the head? No. Did you hear that sound? No. Did you feel me move your body around? Did you notice that your hands are in different places than when you started? I didn't know any of that. That is part of one-pointed concentration. That is not what we call full awareness. What I'm teaching you is full awareness. You will feel things. You will hear things. You will know what's happening around you, but it doesn't make your mind shake. Your equanimity is going to be strong and balanced and accepting. So,
I'm confused. It sounds like those are two different things.
They are.
Opposite.
Right. What I'm teaching you is different than what other people are teaching.
No, the one small kid, you have a loud bell and didn't disturb him at all.
Right. Yeah, but that's at the start of the meditation. Eventually, it didn't matter to them. I should have explained that better. Okay, the enthusiasm. Once you get up to this level of meditation, you start to get a little bit enthusiastic and you start having more fun with it. The decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention. These states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. He understood thus, there's still more to do, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. So you got to a certain level of your understanding, and you're really starting to... You're catching it. And you're able to stay with your object of meditation for longer periods of time. 8 minutes, 10 minutes, 12 minutes. And it's very comfortable. And you really feel like you're progressing. And that's major. Again, with the abandoning of pleasure and pain, with the previous disappearance of joy and grief, Sariputta entered upon and abided in the fourth jhana, which has neither pain nor pleasure and purity of mindfulness due to equanimity. What happens now is your mind goes deeper, and you start to have this very strong equanimity. Now you're radiating loving kindness from your head, but you have this really strong balance. This is where I'm going to change your meditation, and I'll talk about that when it's time. And this is where the Buddha really praised the monks when they got to this level of understanding. Their mind doesn't get so excited anymore. Their mind has this balance in it. Instead of having the emotional highs and lows and going like this, what happens is your mind still has the highs and lows, but they're not drastic. You're not going to be so emotional. and you're going to understand more and more clearly how mind works. The Buddha praised this a lot. And he said, now you have become advanced meditators. Now your understanding is good. When you get to the fourth jhana, and you pick up a Dhamma book, and you start reading it, you will know whether it's really telling you the truth or not. Because you have the direct experience. You will understand. Some Dhamma books, they can be real helpful in some ways, in other ways, you, no, that doesn't agree with my practice. I'm not going to do that part. Or you can pick up one of these books, and you can start reading it, and you will understand it, because you have direct experience. So it's a real important state to get into. Now, what happens after I get you to do go through some changes with your meditation, then I'm going to tell you, now I want you to send loving kindness to six directions, not to individual people anymore, but to all beings. 5 minutes to all beings in front of you. 5 minutes to all beings behind you. 5 minutes to the right, 5 minutes to the left, 5 minutes above, 5 minutes below. That's six directions. Takes about 30 minutes. Then you start radiating loving kindness to all beings in all the directions at the same time. It's like being in a bubble and just radiating out. So, and the states in the fourth jhana, the equanimity, the neither painful nor pleasant feeling, the mental unconcern due to tranquility, the purity of mindfulness and unification of mind, the contact, feeling, perception, preparations, and mind. Now we have the insight again. This is your insight knowledge occurs while you're in the jhana. The enthusiasm, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention, these states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. So you're still seeing change that's happening while you're in the jhana. He understood there's still more to do, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. Now, you are in a mental realm. You don't have body anymore. Now you're in a strictly mental realm. Again, with the complete surmounting of gross perceptions of form. When you were sitting before, when you were in the lower jhanas, you felt your body. That was the gross perception of form. Now, the only way you're going to feel things in your body is if there is contact. Or you put your attention on your body. That is a habit that I have a hard time breaking a lot of people, because they're taught with a Goenka-style meditation to sweep the body. And any kind of sensation is there, put your attention on it, and then do whatever they do. But I don't want you putting your attention on your body at all. Just stay with the loving kindness meditation. Now you're going to be able to sit for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and not have any disturbance. Pull your attention away. Okay. With the disappearance of gross perceptions of sensory impact, aware that space is infinite. Sariputta entered upon and abided in the base of infinite space. What happens is you're radiating loving kindness, and all of a sudden the feeling changes. I won't tell you how it changes. You have to tell me. But it changes to compassion. And also, you're going to start feeling expansion happening in your head. And just the feeling of going out in all directions at the same time. It's not a scary feeling. It's very pleasant. This is called infinite space with compassion. So now you start doing, you go out for a walk and you come back and you start doing the six directions with the feeling of compassion and infinite space. Okay, and as you go deeper, that's going to change by itself. This is a very natural process. So the loving kindness changes to compassion. This is the state that the Buddha sat in every morning for about 2 hours. He radiated compassion to all beings in all the directions with infinite space. And the states in the base of infinite space with compassion. The perception of the base of infinite space with compassion and unification of mind. The contact, feeling, perception, formations, and mind. So you still have the four foundations of mindfulness there. Even though you don't have a body unless there's contact. Okay? You have contact, you will feel that. But it's not going to make your mind shake. It's not going to make your mind go to that. The enthusiasm, decision, energy, mindfulness, equanimity, and attention, these states were defined by him one by one as they occurred. Known to him, those states arose. Known they were present. Known they disappeared. So everything is still in a state of change. They happen one thing at a time, and you're going to see them change from one thing to another, and you're going to understand more deeply how this process works. You're going to have stronger balance in your mind. And it really gets to be fun. You will enjoy it, I promise. He understood that there's still more to do, and with the cultivation of that attainment, he confirmed that there is. Again, by completely surmounting the base of infinite space with compassion, aware that consciousness is infinite. What happens is the feeling of compassion is going to change to a feeling of joy. And this is the awakening factor of joy that doesn't have so much excitement in it. This is just a really happy feeling. So what's going to happen is this feeling of joy is going to come up, and you're going to be able to see at one of the sense doors very, very fast flickering. And what you're seeing is birth, death, birth, death, birth, death, birth, death, arising and passing away, arising and passing away. Now, that wasn't a very good snap, was it? Well, that's the best I got. That was roughly 100,000 arising and passing away of hearing consciousness. When you get to this state, you're going to start seeing individual consciousnesses arise and pass away. It's the birth of, say, sound consciousness and the death of sound consciousness, but it happens very quickly. Now, when you see this, you're going to start to realize more deeply how everything is in a state of change. You're going to see the rapid arising and passing away of consciousnesses. And because it's always changing, it's really unsatisfactory. It gets tiresome because it's always moving, it's always changing. And you're going to see that there's no controller. You're going to see the impersonal nature, up close and personal. Now, sometimes what happens when people get to this state, they can have fear arise. And I've had people call me up on the phone, "What is this? I have this fear and it really is strong. What am I?" Then I start laughing, because it's just mind is throwing a temper tantrum. Mind has thought that it's been in control how many lifetimes? And now it's seeing that this is an impersonal process and it doesn't like it. So it's going to throw up a real big hindrance at you. And the way you overcome the hindrance, the way you overcome this fear, is by laughing. And as soon as you laugh, that fear just fades away. It's nothing. In Asia, there are people that practice black magic. They try to affect other people in negative ways because of jealousy or whatever reason. And they come to me and they say, "Well, what am I supposed to do with this? I'm being affected by whatever this person is doing." So what I tell them to do is visualize a bubble of loving kindness around you and then laugh. People that are wishing you bad things hate it if you laugh, because you're not affecting, they're not affecting you anymore. Yeah.
Go back just a little bit to the point you made before. You said that that nature sort of throws this at you. But that sounds very sort of humanizing of nature. Why would nature do that?
Conditions are right, these things arise.
Sorry?
When conditions are right, these things naturally arise.
Yes, but why can't
Okay, you want to call it that? Fine. Okay. You have your way of describing it, and I have mine.
That's fine.
Okay. Okay. And black magic is a real thing. They call it witchcraft in this country. And some of the witchcraft, they do things to cause problems. Well, laughter is the thing that just repels it. And I had one student that they were starting their own business, and they were just starting to be prosperous, and somebody else went to a black magic guy and got him to cause them to lose their prosperity. And they called me up and said, "What am I supposed to do?" I said, "Well, you have to put a bubble of loving kindness around you. No negative things can break through that." And I said, "If you really want to make them suffer, then put a bubble of loving kindness around them. Because when they send it out, that it hits that bubble and bounces back at them." And you have to laugh. Laughter is incredibly powerful. And we don't do it enough. That's the fastest way to let go of any kind of disturbance that happens in your mind, is to laugh. Because you go from "I am that," where you're really concerned about whatever it is, to "it's only that." After you laugh, it changes your perspective. It changes the way you see things. And do you want to carry this one around with you, this fear, this anxiety? Nah, let that go. So that's one of the reasons I told you at the start of the retreat, I want you to smile, I want you to laugh, I want you to have fun. Why? Because that helps your mind be uplifted. And it helps to let go of negative influences around you. So it's real important to remember that. And you'll probably forget. And then you'll call me up and say, "What am I supposed to do?" I laugh. That's it. Okay, bye.
So she was helping an old lady with the shoe, her shoes on them. A flasher came into the store, and he flashed her, and my friend just started laughing her head off, and he was so disturbed.
Oh, yeah.
He ran over to the thrifties and just flashed the whole world and ended up getting arrested. But the point is how it will totally deflect what's coming at you.
Yeah.
They don't know how to handle it. I get attacked every now and then. Sometimes it's they try to attack me in dreams. Sometimes they try to attack me in other ways. And as soon as you start laughing, they become frustrated because they think they're really going to get you. And they can't. It's impossible. I have loving kindness with me, and I laugh whenever I see some of this negative stuff that starts to happen. So this really does work. And the more you can develop laughing with things, the happier your mind becomes, the more uplifted your mind becomes, the more fun everything becomes. So, what to do? Have fun. Okay. Again, by completely surmounting the base of infinite consciousness with joy, aware that there is nothing. Sariputta enters upon and abided in the base of nothingness. Now, what happens is the joy will disappear. And your mind will become very tranquil and very peaceful. And mind stops looking outside of itself. Now you're not seeing anything. It's just dark. There's nothing to see. But this is one of the more interesting states that you can be in, which sounds kind of weird because there's nothing. But this is where you start to learn more and more about the balance and how to stay with your object of meditation and how you need to change it every now and then. If you start putting in too much energy and staying with your object of meditation, your mind's going to get restless. If you don't put enough energy into it, your mind's going to dull out. So you have to learn how to adjust. Sometimes you might have to adjust two or three times in a sitting. When you get to this state, you're going to experience really, really strong equanimity, balance of mind, no excitement. Hey, how's your meditation going? Fine. Everything is fine. You having fun now? Yeah. Nothing gets your mind excited when you get into this equanimity. It's very nice. And you learn how to adjust the amount of energy you need to stay with that. And this is fine-tuning the amount of energy you need to stay with your object of meditation. Now your object of meditation is the equanimity. But if you put too much in, you're going to get restless. And you'll start to see it coming, and then you got to back off. A lot of people, when they get to these different deeper stages like this, they try to get into a control mode where they think that they're going to make the meditation better by, I'm gonna really concentrate more deeply on your object of meditation, which is equanimity now. And then you're gonna have to learn how to back off. You don't put extra energy in. If you want to stay with your object of meditation, you have to learn to adjust tiny bits at a time. Okay? And there's other things that happen when you get into that state, and I'm not going to talk to you about that. You have to tell me about it. But you do your six directions with equanimity, and you're going to start sitting longer. 3 hours, 4 hours. And you're going to feel very comfortable doing it. I had one lady that came, and I had taught her one retreat before. And when she came, she thought, okay, I'm going to get into this equanimity, and I'm going to sit for 12 hours. And she did. I don't recommend it. Not right now, anyway. But I'll tell you, don't ask me how long you think I should be sitting. Because 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours, okay, that's fine. No problem. But when you start sitting longer, you need to get more exercise. You need to get your blood moving, because when you sit for a long time, the blood settles in your legs. And if you don't get moving and get that blood circulating again, you can get blood clots and all kinds of problems. And I don't want that to happen for you. That did happen to me. Because I was in Burma, I just got to this one teacher. First day of the retreat, I go in for my interview. How long do you sit? I say, I sit for an hour, walk for an hour. That was standard practice at that time. Well, why don't you sit longer? Okay. Come in the next day. How long did you sit? Sat for 2 hours, walk for an hour. Oh, good. Why don't you sit longer? Yeah, okay. I come in the next day. How long did you sit? Sat for 3 hours, walk for an hour. It's pretty difficult. Okay, why don't you sit longer? Oh, man. Okay. Come back in. How long did you sit? Sat for 4 hours. It was a killer. A lot of pain coming up. He said, did you move? And I said, yeah, I moved all over the place. This is painful. Well, don't move. Oh, man. Okay. I came in next day. How long did you sit? I sat for 4 hours. Did you move? No, and I never want to do that again. And he said, well, why don't you sit longer? No. Mm-mm. No way. In 4 days, I've gone from a comfortable sitting for 1 hour to sitting for 4 hours with a lot of pain. And he thought that was kind of cute. I thought it was not very cute, and it was real painful. But eventually he kept after me, and I started sitting 6 hours, 8 hours, like that. But what happened is they're walking meditation. They wanted you to walk really, really, really slowly. So you didn't get the exercise that you needed. From that wall to that wall, took me about 45 minutes to walk it. That shows you how slow I was walking. I mean, I was picking up my foot like this. And they want you to see the intention of every tiny little movement of your body's movement. And it's kind of like a blank spot in between every little movement. And I was seeing 500, 1,000 movements just in picking my foot up. And then I would move it forward, and I would see all of these different movements, and then I would put it back down, and I would see all these different movements. It took me a long time to go anyplace. But I didn't get exercise. And I developed blood clots. And that's why I have trouble with my legs now. So I don't want you to do that. I want you to walk so that you're walking so fast that you're breathing through your mouth. Okay? So that means run up the hill. Or run up and down stairs for a little bit so that you get your blood moving again. But while you're doing that, you still want to stay with the equanimity, that balance of mind. Now, every jhana that you go into, from the first jhana till where we are right now, you can be in that jhana while you're walking. That means your mindfulness has to be fairly good. And it takes practice to get there. But when you get into the arupa jhanas, that means from infinite space to neither perception nor non-perception, when you're walking, you'll feel the bottom of your feet because there is contact there, but you won't feel the rest of your body. It's really kind of an odd feeling. Just where there's contact, if the wind blows and it blows some cloth on your leg, you'll feel that because there's contact. Otherwise, you don't really know you have a body. It's interesting. So when you get to nothingness, where you're not looking outside of mind anymore, you should be sitting no less than 3 hours. Okay? And that might sound like a real long time right now, but it gets easier as you go through all of the different stages. And you'll kind of like the idea of sitting that long, because your mind becomes real peaceful and real calm and strong balance in your mind. Excuse me. And eventually what happens is the equanimity will disappear. When that happens, now you start, your mind becomes really, really exquisitely peaceful. Very nice. No movement of mind's attention. Now you're taking mind as your object of meditation. Excuse me. So you're just watching nothing. No movement of mind's attention at all. But if you see mind's attention move even a little tiny bit, then you relax, let it be, and stay with the quiet mind. Now you'll be able to sit for longer periods of time. You'll be able to sit without any disturbance in your mind for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, half an hour, 45 minutes, an hour. I had one student in Malaysia. He was a great meditator. He was really good. And he came in for the interview. How long did you sit? Sat for 3 hours. Okay. How long did you sit without any movement of mind's attention? 3 hours. Really? 3 hours without any movement of mind's attention? Yeah. I'm impressed. Don't think that that's going to happen for you. There's only one meditator that I've run across that could do that. But what's going to happen is eventually your mind is going to become so pure and so alert that what's going to happen is that everything all of a sudden will just stop. You don't know you're in this state until you come out of it. This is called the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. When you come out of that state, you are going to feel very strong relief. If your mindfulness is very good, you will see very tiny little movements of mind's attention. Sometimes they describe it as dots, sometimes dashes. It's described in different ways for different people, but it's very tiny movements. And when that stops, you will feel joy, heavy duty. You're really going to be happy. You have just experienced Nibbana. You have just given up an ocean of suffering. You're not ever going to be born less than a human being. You have 7 more lifetimes that you can be reborn. And then you get off the wheel of samsara. No more suffering. So, this is a very interesting state. And I will congratulate you and tell you what a great job you've done. And then I'll say, okay, go back and sit. Why? I've already experienced Nibbana. You've only experienced the first little taste of it. You need to experience the fruition, which is a similar kind of experience. But it kind of sets everything in concrete. It makes things a lot more steady. And your understanding and the changes of personality are great. You start to get to be more happy all the time. You will keep your precepts without breaking them, because if you break them, you're really going to feel guilty. So you're more careful with your daily activities, but you start to see more and more clearly how you cause your own problems. You cause your own pain. And you start to learn from that and let it go. Now, in the good qualities of the Sangha, there's one part that talks about the noble Sangha. The noble Sangha is people that have experienced Nibbana. You have become a saint at that time. And that's much different than the Catholic saints. Okay, that's not even close. But there are, it's called 8 kinds of individuals. 4 pairs of individuals. That's a person that has experienced sotapanna, that's called a stream enterer, with fruition. That's one pair. Then there's a sakdagami, it's called a once returner, that you come back to the human state one more time at the most. From there you attain Nibbana and get off the wheel. But you do that with fruition. So that's 2 pairs. Then you keep going. You keep doing the practice. You'll get to a place where you no longer experience lust or hatred ever again in your mind. You're never going to have any fear. You're never going to have any anxiety. Your mind is going to be clear. Your mind is going to be filled with loving kindness most of the time. And you're going to have super strong mindfulness and good collectedness of mind. You're going to experience A level of balance in your mind that you've never experienced before. No excitement. You become disenchanted with things. The things that used to make your mind excited, seeing your favorite food, or being excited when you go to the store to buy something new, your mind just isn't going to be so interested in that anymore. But you're going to be able to spend more time radiating loving kindness to other people. And that makes life fun. Now, I have some students that have this kind of experience. And I love hanging out with them. They're the most fun people I've ever been around because they're happy. They're really uplifted. They're not going to try to fool you. They're not going to try to con you out of things. They're just happy folks, and it's real nice to be around them. You can experience this state, as high as it is, on this retreat, if you follow the directions exactly, precisely. Okay? So, I might have one student that is an arahat. It is up for grabs. I have to go spend time with her before I know whether she really has experienced it or not. But there is the claim that she is an arahat. But I have to go to Russia to find her. And she lives in Russia. One of the things, one of my monk friends who's traveled all over the world many times, and he went to Russia. Oh, this was back in the, must have been the early 80s, that he'd gone to Russia, and he came back and he said, you know, there's really not much difference between the youth in this country and the young people in Russia. They are looking for a lot of healing stuff and more spiritually inclined. And 2 years, 3 years ago, I went to, and I taught some Russian students. And I was amazed at how fast they progressed in their meditation. It was really remarkable. So, it's quite interesting, the different cultures. You know, you go to Thailand, and the Thai think that they're much superior to other people. And when I give a talk there, I say, you know, there's really no difference between Thai and American. Your mind works exactly in the same way. And boy, does that make them unhappy. They don't like that idea, yeah.
What do you think it was that made the Russians so incredibly good at the time?
They've been through a lot of suffering. They've seen a lot of suffering. They've right after Russia fell, there was very little food around, so they started practicing helping other people. And they developed that generosity. And their curiosity is such that they really want to know. They want to know exactly how everything works. And they were ready. What more can you say? They might have had it in a past lifetime. They might have been meditators. Who knows? But I had two people doing forgiveness meditation, and I explained it to him. And they had a translator, and he ran across the word forgiveness, and he said, "We don't have a word for forgiveness." Really? Ah, okay. So we had to come up with another word, so we used the word acceptance. And tried to put the word soft in that, soft acceptance. And they got it. There was one girl that, from the time she was 11 or 12 years old, I don't remember her exact age, every night she was sleepwalking. So she came, and she was in her 30s. I mean, she really had a major problem with sleepwalking. And her husband had to be up with her all night to make sure she didn't walk out of the house and get hurt some way or another. So I had her doing forgiveness meditation and saw that she had an awful lot of fear. And one of the things that helps overcome fear is reciting the good qualities of the Buddha. Okay? And I had her doing that 3 times a day and doing forgiveness meditation. After 4 days, she had a full night's sleep. She couldn't believe it. And her husband was, he was ecstatic. He got a full night's sleep too. But it was pretty amazing to see how forgiveness meditation really worked for them as soon as we got the translation so that it was good. So there's this kind of meditation is about developing the ability to be in harmony with yourself and other people. Not fighting, not arguing, being in harmony. I have some friends in Malaysia and Indonesia. I met them here, and then they moved to Indonesia. And they had just gotten married. And the husband, right before he got married, his father came to him and he said, "Do you want a successful marriage?" And he said, "Yes." He said, "It's real simple. Everything she says is right. Make everything that she says right. And that way you're not going to argue. You're not going to fight with them. You're not going to have disagreements." That was 9 years ago, and they haven't had a disagreement yet. They haven't fought. They have a great relationship. It's very loving and kind. Of course, both of them are meditating with me. And it's really inspiring being around them. So I try to tell that to folks, that just make the woman right. Don't argue. Don't fight. Let them be right, and then you can discuss and see how you can adjust. But blowing up and being angry when one of the spouses says something, that doesn't work at all. So this is about being in harmony. This is about really having a mind that is loving and accepting and generous. And developing that as much as you possibly can. And life becomes fun.